Hello, my name is Marvin William Young, and I have some documents that I'd like to present to you today that will prove criminal activity. The sole purpose of this video is to shed light on my research that I have done over the past 3 years. On February the 25th, 2011, my father, Charles William Young, of 12968 Highway 68, Helico Plains, Tennessee, which is located in the community of Coker Creek, passed away at his home alone and was found by his wife at the time, Deborah Jean Gray Young, at approximately 6 p.m. Upon learning of my father's death, I was living in North Florida and immediately made the trip to Coker Creek. When I arrived at Coker Creek, I went by my father's house. And there I met Deborah for the very first time. I'd always been told for years if something happened to my father that my cousin, Kevin Rowe, would be the executor of his estate. And I knew upon his death that Kevin would be there, and sure enough he was. They directed me to my father's rental cabin next door, and I went to see Kevin. When I got over there, I had several questions for Kevin, and one of them was, "Are you the executor of my father's estate?" And he says, "Yes, I am," which is completely not true. He wasn't and never had been. It was just a lie. Well, we talked for a while on the back porch. I took my information and I left, and I went back to my friend's house where I was staying. The next morning, I went to the Monroe County Courthouse located in Madisonville, Tennessee, and I went to the probate office. And I asked a nice lady if I could have a copy of my father's will. He had just passed away. And she said, "I'm sorry, I don't have a copy of your will. It hasn't been recorded yet." I says, "Well, do you have any recommendations for attorneys that takes care of probate?" She had a couple, one of which was Clifford Wilson. Clifford Wilson's office is located in Courthouse Square. So I walked to his office and asked to meet with him. He met with me, and while sitting in his office, I noticed that Mr. Wilson was blind. And I started to explain to him what I was there for, and didn't get too far into it, and he stopped me, and he told me, "Mr. Young," he says, "I can stop you right there." He says, "I'm just not going to be able to help you," he says, "because I'm actually representing Charlie's widow, Deborah, and I won't be able to help you." I said, "I understand that." I says, "While I'm here, I understand there was a will." And he said, there is. I says, "Well, I'd like to have a copy of it." So he instructed his secretary to get me a copy of it. When she brought it to me, it was 2 pages, and it was created on a computer and printed off, which immediately raised suspicions for me, because my father was meticulous about his business, and even more so with his legal business. And that just didn't make any sense, that this was his will. Every legal matter he'd ever had, he always used an attorney, from as far back as I know of. Well, when I received that will, and these documents I'll put up, I'll overlay on the video, as I talk about those. When I received the will, it was 2 pages. And I was very surprised at that. My father had a fairly sizable estate, quite a few pieces of land in several different states. He was in his middle 60s, quite accomplished in business, and had an untold amount of assets, as well as the assets of his parents. which was a just one in particular was a piece of property in Tarpon Springs. It sold for over $1 million. It was supposed to be dispersed among the grandchildren, and never was. So I was really surprised that his estate would be dispersed with a will no bigger than this, and that it was privately made. Didn't say anything to Mr. Wilson about what I had noticed. I didn't figure it'd do any good, but when I turned the cover page over to the signature page, as you see here, I noticed on the line that says Charles W. Young, there was a signature above that line that said Charlie W. Young. Which caught my attention immediately, because whoever signed it misspelled his name. But even more so than that, the name on the line didn't match the name under the line. Even if they had spelled it right, Charlie was not the way it was meant to be signed. It was meant to be signed Charles. And my father never signed anything that he didn't sign it Charles. I've put the challenge out there to anyone that I've talked to, attorneys, officials, anybody, to present a document that my father signed other than Charles Young. That document doesn't exist, because he's never signed anything other than Charles Young. Well, I took that information and I went to the next recommendation of attorneys to take care of probate, showed him what I had found. He was very, very interested in what I had. He could see exactly what I could see on the document, which I at the time believed was a forgery, and now have even more evidence to support that. And then went by the courthouse and acquired all the public documents there were for my father, which at the time were 5 deeds. And I acquired those for reasons of comparing signatures. My father was a draftsman in school, and for a man, he had particularly nice penmanship and a very unique signature. And I knew immediately when I seen this signature in Mr. Wilson's office, this is not my father's signature. And not to mention that his last will and testament would never be printed off of a computer, and it surely wouldn't consist of 2 pages. So after talking with that attorney for a little bit, it seemed like I was going to be able to retain him. So I left my documents with him, and I left and I went back to Florida the next day. A little bit of time had passed, roughly 6 weeks. I might mention this. While I was in Mr. Wilson's office, he said that they were in the process of executing this will, but there was a problem with affidavits. Affidavits of attesting witnesses. And I says, is that a normal procedure? Is that something that you have to take care of after a person dies? And he says, no, quite the contrary. He says, actually, this is something that should be taken care of at the same time the will is written. And this will was supposedly written in 2005, 30th day of December. And this was February of 2011, and there was no affidavits associated with the will. He had told me that Deborah Young had brought him the will for execution, but he did not create it. I went back to Florida, self-employed. 2011, as a lot of you know, the housing industry was on its way down. My business was directly related to the housing business. I was having a tough go at it. I had lived in Tennessee before. My elder child was born in Tennessee, and I had intentions on moving back to Tennessee, but it happened a little sooner than I expected. Between the economy and the death of my father, I ended up moving back in April of that year, or excuse me, October of that year, 2011. I made several trips before October back and forth to Tennessee, trying to collect all the information I could and possibly come to some type of understanding of what was going on here, because I definitely knew something wasn't right. Let me get my timeline right here so I get everything right. Mr. Lewis Kennard, which is who I attempted to retain, did receive some mail and some correspondence with Clifford Wilson for me, one of which is an affidavit of attesting witness. Dated April the 8th, 2011, and this witness, alleged witness, is Evelyn N. Birkin. Well, when I received this in the mail, it immediately raised suspicions because it was a state of Tennessee document, but Tennessee had been scratched out and the word Georgia had been written in. And the county of, and the blank line was filled in, Barrow County. Well, I thought that to be strange because I knew there was a notary public in Mr. Clifford's, you know, office, or at least in Madisonville, and was really curious why a woman named Phyllis Meyer would be asked to notarize this document and her living way down in Barrow County. So I attempted to call or find Evelyn N. Birkin and didn't have any luck, still haven't had any luck. So the next person to call was, there's two witnesses on this alleged will. One being Evelyn N. Birkin, two being Richard K. Gray, which I assume just by the names that he was related to Deborah, which indeed he was. He's her brother. So I attempted to contact Richard K. Gray. Took a little bit to find him because on the nomination of executor, he's listed as a witness along with Evelyn N. Birkin. And He is listed as a Johnson City resident. She's listed as a Knoxville resident. So I started the search for Mr. Gray. It led me to Auburn, Alabama. I acquired his phone number and I gave him a call. And I recorded the conversation. I started asking him questions about this will. And he was having a little bit of difficulty answering these questions. I asked him when he witnessed this paper, if he remembered it, in 2005, when he supposedly had witnessed this. He didn't remember that. He remembered signing these papers in 2011 at the request of Deborah. And he had informed me, and I have audio tape of proof of this, that he signed many papers for Deborah just because she asked him to. Now, he's supposed to be a witness to the fact that my father signed this paper. And I'm already finding out that that was not true. So it didn't surprise me any at all that I couldn't get a hold of Evelyn Birkin. And I also believe that she probably didn't witness it either. And what made me think that is that this affidavit of attesting witness that I received is dated April the 8th, 2011. Well, that's 2 months after my father's death. The notary is from out of state, which I didn't know at the time, but I found out that that is criminal. It's against the law, and it's actually a felony. I found this out through the Superior Court of Georgia, where Miss Meyer has her notary through. And just knew something was fishy. Well, gathered my information, had to go back to Florida. I made several trips. Due to my financial situations, I could barely make trips, but it was far cheaper than hiring an attorney, which I just could not do. So I just continued to try to do my own research and just compile the evidence as much as I could. So that hopefully one day, either if I had the money or could find someone who would help me with this, that I'd have my ducks in a row. I had proof of, in my opinion, already of criminal activity, and couldn't get anybody to help me with this at all. I didn't think it was my place to have to hire an attorney. I know if there's a crime committed, if a person breaks in your home, that you don't have to go hire an attorney. All you have to do is call the law. And the law comes, and they prove the crime, and the district attorney prosecutes. Well, I thought that I would have the same opportunity. Well, I know that through different things that I'd heard in the family, that Sheriff Bill Bivens of Monroe County was a personal friend of my father's. Apparently, he'd done some paint work on my father's antique car, which was my great-grandfather's. And he was personal friends with Deborah and played music at their home. And my father had several friends that were good friends with Sheriff Bivens. And I thought that he was an individual that I could go and sit and talk with and explain my circumstances of what I'd found, and that he would be upfront and honest with me. So I went and requested a meeting with him, and he met with me, and I sat down and I showed him the documents that I had and told my story. As you can see, there's absolutely no question about the validity of this signature compared to my father's signature. It's simply a forgery. And it's the difference between daylight and dark, and it just doesn't take a genius to figure this out. I was kind of surprised that Sheriff Bivens didn't share the same opinion that I had and so many others had that I had showed this document to. But I understand his position, and he just didn't want to say anything, and that's fine. I was glad that he met with me. I recorded that conversation. And after a short meeting, I left and went back to my friend's house at Cucker Creek where I was staying, and then eventually back to Florida. Well, while I was here the first time, after my father's funeral, and I acquired those deeds that I told you about, I was building a little packet here that I could send around to different people, trying to get them to help me. And at the recommendation of Sheriff Bivens, I contacted the district attorney in Cleveland, Steve Bebb, and sent him from Florida, faxed him from Florida, all the documents that I had acquired, the will, the signature pages, everything that I had. He reviewed them, called me back, gave me a straight up front opinion that there's no way in the world that this could be my father's signature, and that he believed that there was criminal activity. Well, I thought finally at that point, I've got the district attorney on my side, but it was just another dead end. So I didn't know what else to do. I'd exhausted every avenue that I could think of. So I just kind of shelved this stuff for a while. Tried to get on with my life, made a move, trying to get things in order. And then I received a phone call from a friend in Cocoa Creek that Deborah had remarried. She had married 7 months after my father's death, which was very surprising. My father and Deborah were supposedly, madly in love and love of each other's life, and I was really surprised. The brother, Richard K. Gray of Auburn, Alabama, I've talked to him quite a bit, and he was very surprised. Phyllis Meyer was very surprised. Numerous people in the community of Cocoa Creek was very surprised that she was to marry so fast. They got married, and some more time passed. Well, I received a phone call one day from that same friend in Cocoa Creek that Deborah had passed. And that kind of changed everything at that point. With Deborah passing, I knew that some legal matters would be taken care of. Possibly could be some legal action taken against her estate. Statute of limitations had already expired of 24 months on my father's estate. I've had several attorneys tell me that there was another 12 months for a total of 36 months, an extension, if fraud is involved. Never could get anybody, talked to multiple attorneys, and never could get anybody to do anything about that. So I decided in April that after learning that this David Godwin was the brother of an acquaintance of mine that I had done some mechanicking for when I had a shop in Cocoa Creek years ago. And he owns the grounds in which the Gold Prospectors of America are on in Cocoa Creek. I'm a GPAA member. David Godwin is a GPAA member. his brother Jimmy that I'm speaking of, he's a GPAA member, the one that owns the property, the GPAA property camp is on. David Godwin was in the military. I'm very active in the military, recognition of military. I wear a bracelet of a missing in action Vietnam veteran. Been very, very active in that. I thought maybe I'd found, you know, an individual with enough in common that, you know, he might be a kindred spirit. Maybe he'd be somebody that would be fair, that I could talk with, explain my situation to, understood that he claimed to be a Christian man, and just felt all the way around that, you know, this would be an individual that I could sit and talk with. So on April the 10th, I chose to go to my father's home and sit on the porch and talk with Mr. Godwin. He met with me and we sat and talked, and seemed to be a nice man. Talked with me. I showed him all the paperwork, showed him the will, showed him all those signature pages of my father's that I had acquired. He totally agreed that things didn't look right. Looked like I got the bad end of this whole deal, and that he was more than willing to help me and, you know, make things right. And little did I know, in less than an hour, he would have me locked up on criminal charges. And I have no doubt it's because I had undisputed proof that everything he had, he was going to lose. So, went to jail twice because of this situation. Was released on a $100,000 bond. Had to borrow the money to get out of jail. Put me in debt, as you can imagine. Finances were already exhausted, hadn't worked in a few years, didn't have the need to, but now all of a sudden, you know, definitely needed to. But I needed all the time in the world I could to fight this, because now, you know, I was faced with even more challenges. So it wasn't too many days after that, and my friend Jack Thrumston, that been a lifelong friend of my father's, knew him since the age of 16, knew me before I was born, obviously, had been, you know, nearly 50-year friend of my father's. Was actually a caretaker of my father's home for many years, helped build my father's home there in Cocoa Creek. This next door neighbor, this tenant, if you will, of my father's, Miss Deborah's and now David's, made a choice to go to Jack's house, and because she had heard what was happening to me, what I was being charged with, and she felt she had information that would help me in this situation. So she went to Jack, and Jack contacted me, and I gave him permission to give her my phone number, and she contacted me, and she agreed to meet with me at the Hardee's in Madisonville. I offered Hardee's in Madisonville. I wanted to feel safe and be in public. So we met and talked, and found out quite a few things that were quite surprising. When she went to Jack's house, she expressed that she was very, very scared, very scared of David Godwin. Apparently he had, after our encounter, he walked around the property with a shotgun and was worried about me. Had no reason to worry about me, don't understand why, other than the fact that I had proof that everything that he had and the home he was living in belongs to my family, and I had proof of it. So, got to talking with Miss Nancy. She told me that her and her brother at one time stood on my father's porch, and David Godwin made the comment that, look at everything that I have inherited, shortly after he married Deborah, which I figured to be a, you know, that's a profound statement. You just marry a woman, and you make a statement like that. If you marry this woman to take care of her and because you love her, probably the last statement you would make is one like that. Her brother, Nancy Johnson's brother, was present during that statement. When another statement that was made to Miss Nancy Johnson at a separate time was right after Miss Deborah had passed, David had made the comment that he didn't mean to overdose her on potassium. I understand that she was on a potassium iron or potassium calcium regimen. He was in control of this. Now, this is all stuff that was told to me by Nancy Johnson. I have it on tape. She she has contacted Jack several times, gave us her phone number, told us she would be more than willing to testify in court to the things that I'm telling you right now. She's since had to move from my father's property and find another home. She's still to this day not allowed back in that home to get the rest of her personal possessions because she has chose to help me. She's getting harder and harder to find, I think, because the closer and closer we get to my court date, she is she's getting scarier and scarier, and she's more afraid that something might happen to her, because between the information that I have and her testimony, this would not be good for Mr. Godwin. Well, at that point, I pulled my file back off the shelf and I started digging through it again, and I wanted to start getting some answers. So I went back to that affidavit of attesting witness, and I started contacting. Couldn't find Evelyn Birkin. So Phyllis Meyer was the next in line, the notary public from Barrow County, Georgia. I contacted her, recorded that message on that recording, in that conversation. I questioned Miss Meyer quite a bit about different things. I asked her if she knew Evelyn Birkin. She said she did. I asked her how she knew her. She said that she was a sponsor of her in the AA, and apparently Miss Meyer was in AA years ago, or still is. I'm not sure that circumstance, but that's how she's connected with Miss Birkin. And Miss Birkin was supposed to have lived in Knoxville, and Miss Meyer, living in Barrow County, Georgia, she made statements that Miss Birkin had stayed on her couch before. Kind of a weird connection there, so far away, Barrow County, Georgia, way up in Knoxville like that. It's long ways between each other. I asked if she knew where Evelyn Birkin was at, and she said that she didn't. And last time she'd heard that she was in jail, somewhere in Georgia or possibly Tennessee, for cooking meth. And once she learned that, she so-called fired her from the AA sponsorship type thing, and haven't had any more contact with her. Well, that's kind of a strange connection. Miss Meyer said in past recordings that I have that she didn't have, you know, that much of a personal relationship with Deborah Young. But when she came to Coker Creek, she looked her up to rent a cabin from her several different times. And I guess Deborah felt that she could ask her to notarize these papers. Now, in that conversation with Miss Meyer, she said the last time that she was at that house was in the last few days of March of 2011. Well, this affidavit of attesting witness was signed April the 8th of the same year, just 6, 7, 8 days later. I guess it's just a coincidence. At different times, she said she didn't take the time to read the will, which wouldn't have been hard. It was only 2 paragraphs. Single page, as you've seen. But she quoted it several times on that phone conversation, exactly to the letter, exactly where things were supposed to go. So I don't think that her memory's that good from 2005, you know, at the time of this conversation. But it would probably be a little fresher if all these signatures and everything were taken care of in 2011. And I have some more evidence to support that that'll come here shortly. I learned in that conversation, you know, all these people that are involved in this thing are connected somehow, some way. After all this happened with Mr. Godwin, I started contacting people that I knew in the community that I had known in the past when I had my shop in Coker Creek. I would eat breakfast at Hardee's and Telco Plains every morning with the man that I was renting a place from doing body work in Coker Creek, and I was doing mechanic work. We would eat every morning, and we would sit with Charles Hall, the former mayor of Telco. Charles was a real nice fella. Got to know him quite well. That's actually how I met Jimmy Godwin, David's brother. He was running seafood and stuff, had a little truck, needed some work on. I'd done some work on his truck. Met all these people, had a good rapport with these people. And come to find out, Miss Meyer's nephew married Charles Hall's daughter. So that's just another connection that puts these people together. Through the whole conversation, Miss Myers made very strong claims of being a very strong Christian woman. And I was kind of surprised that when I started questioning her about these documents, that was some of the answers I got. Well, not long after April the 10th, I was contacted by Jack Thrumston and was informed that David Godwin had taken out criminal trespassing charges against him. And I'll put that document up on the screen here, so you can see the statement that was written, handwritten, by Mr. Godwin. He's claiming that Nancy Johnson came to him and told him that Jack Thrumston came to her house, knocked on the side of her trailer, and started questioning her about me and my case, and that he was there in my behalf, which is completely not true, and Miss Nancy Johnson will testify in court to that, that she actually went to Jack first because she was afraid, and she had talked to me, and I told her that Jack would be protection for her, that if she ever felt threatened, that she could go to Jack and Jack would help her. And she has gone back a time or two since then for such a thing. And he told me that he was taking criminal trespassing charges out on him, and his statement was a complete lie. Also, the statement that was made to put me in jail was later proven to be wrong, in my opinion, because the statement in court completely contradicted it. So that's the second perjury. It's the second time that he lied. Actually, the third, if you want to include the 8th, 9th, and 10th of April, when David Godwin lied to Richard Gray, Deborah's brother, about the cremation. As I've said, it was common knowledge that Deborah wanted to be her body donated to science like her father was, and 2 days later she was cremated completely against her will and any wishes that she had expressed to anybody. So that's kind of odd. I think a lot of questions needs to be asked of Mr. Godwin of why he would do such a thing. He had made statements to Richard Gray that he knew she wanted to be donated to science. He made a comment on the telephone to Richard Gray that he knew that. He actually told Richard Gray on the phone the 8th, the 9th, and the 10th that he was in town taking care of the paperwork to have her body donated to science, and which was a complete lie. The family was relying on viewing Miss Deborah. They have yet to have a memorial. And that's just a shame. That's a shame. There's no reason in the world why anybody would cremate somebody that fast unless there's an ulterior motive. So a lot of questions should be asked. That conversation ended. She stated different things like, she was retired from Gwinnett County and things of that sort. And I learned quite a bit about Miss Meyer at that time and told her of the different things that I had. Well, from the time of April the 10th, shortly after that, I received a envelope in the mail. No return address, come out of Tampa, Florida. Under the circumstances that I had just gone through, I was quite concerned about what this could possibly be, especially with no return address on it. And I was very reluctant to open it, and thank God I didn't, without witnesses. It was sent to Jack's address in my name. It was common knowledge on the mountain that Jack and I were friends. He was like a father to me. So they knew that anything that went to Jack's house would make it to me. And so I went and picked it up, received a phone call from Jack, which I have saved, stating that there's a sealed envelope at my house for you. I went by and picked it up. Immediately went to a friends of mine's place of business with two other friends, husband and wife, and all three of those witnessed me open this envelope, and they are more than willing to testify in court under oath that what was in this envelope is exactly indeed what I said was in this envelope. What was in this envelope was another envelope that had Miss Deborah's name on it and my father's address. Obviously had been sent to her. The return address was that of Phyllis Meyer in Georgia, which I thought to be kind of odd. She's come all the way from Georgia to Tennessee, supposedly, to notarize this will in front of a witness. Why would she be sending paperwork to Miss Deborah after the fact? All that paperwork would have been taken care of on the spot. Well, inside that envelope was duplicate papers of this computer-printed will. Several copies of nomination of executor, several copies of attesting witness, several copies of the front page of this will. Now, the strange thing about this, not only just the duplicate copies of everything, I think we know that when you go and have a will made up that's legit, you only have one copy, it's all taken care of at one time. Any mistakes are removed, things are finalized, and then it's recorded. You don't have multiple copies. Well, on those multiple copies was the signatures of Evelyn Birkin, as you'll see here. And signatures of Richard K. Gray, the brother, but no signature of my father's. So these are almost like practice papers. And there is one paper in there that does have my father's signature on it. At least this time, they did spell his name, Charlie, with an R. But even that signature, as you'll see, is not even close to the signature on the original document. And that's characteristics of a forgery. You just can't sign the name the same way every time if it's not your signature. So now, you know, I had information that I thought was, you gotta be kidding me, really? I've got this will with undisputed proof that is the signature's a forgery. Now I have copies of multiple copies, duplicate copies of the same will with a completely different signature on it again. And then several blank pieces of paper that had been witnessed, but no signature. If you sign four or five pieces of paper and you practice signing a person's name on it and you get the one that you're happy with, then you take that one and you file it. And I believe that's exactly what happened. I don't think it was a coincidence that Ms. Deborah used Mr. Wilson, the attorney in Madisonville, and took advantage of him being blind, not being able to see the documents and see the signature, which just helped this thing go ahead. So after getting off the phone with Miss Meyer, I chose to call Richard Gray. And I called Richard Gray and told him what I'd found, what I'd received, and he was appalled, to be quite honest with you, because I asked him to start out with if he'd ever got to, is there ever a funeral for Deborah? And he says, no. He says, I've had so many people call me and want to know where the memorial is going to be so that they can attend, friends from school and family members. And he just didn't have an answer for him because, you know, David had told him that the body was going to be donated to science, and that he would be getting back with him. That David had stated that someone had broken his house and that he was just going to kind of put everything on hold, which doesn't quite much, make sense to me. If a person's passed away, you're going to carry on with that procedure. What's going to happen to the body while you put this on hold? It's just not going to set somewhere. Especially if it's going to be donated to science. This stuff needs to be done in very short order, to preserve the body. Which, we now know she was already cremated by the time she was talking to Richard. So when I informed him of that, he made phone calls to the funeral home and teleco, verified everything I was saying, and was just disgusted with David. And according to him, he made no more contact with him, which I thought to be kind of strange as well, because if my sister had possibly been, something had happened to her, overdosed or whatever, and her body was cremated, days later, and then her husband lied to me, I'd be quite upset, and I'd want some answers. But for some reason, he just chose not to do anything about it, and that's kind of strange to me. Well, I asked him if he knew Evelyn Birkin, because, you know, according to Phyllis Meyer on her conversation I had before, that I've taped, she stated that Evelyn Birkin was there at the house that day with Deborah when she notarized this attesting affidavit of attesting witness, and that there was a guy there. She assumed it was Deborah's brother. If she's a witness, they're going to be introduced to each other. They're going to be told who they are. So she's going to know if this man was her brother or not. So that's strange. Plus, have her brother telling me on tape that the last time he was there was in December of 2012, that he wasn't there during that March or April meeting with Deborah and Miss Meyer. So those two stories don't support each other. He said he'd never heard of Evelyn Birkin before. I believe that that if he had witnessed a paper with Miss Birkin, that he would at least remember her name. And it only being 2011, and this conversation being in 2013, it was just a little over a year. He would remember that. I asked him if he knew a Miss Meyer. He said, "No, I'd never heard of this person before, never even heard her name." Which again is hard to believe that he doesn't know the notary that signed his signature, or verified his signature with notary stamp. He wouldn't know her. That was quite strange. I asked him if he remembered signing these papers at all. And again, he told me that he had signed many papers for Deborah without any question, just because she asked him to. Now he's got four signatures on four duplicate pieces of paper, and he's claiming that he don't remember any of that. And he said that he can't swear that he signed any of these papers in front of my father. If that's the case, then I think a lot of questions needs to be asked of David Gray. Excuse me, Richard Gray. A lot of questions need to be asked of a lot of people that's involved in this. Nothing adds up. None of the stories are the same as the other stories I've gotten. There's a lot of motive here to cover a lot of things up. Myself and my family have been completely excluded from any family heirlooms. I don't have a picture of my father. I don't have a picture of my grandparents. I don't have any possessions that were left to me. None of the cousins, or I should say, my cousins, but none of the grandchildren received anything from my grandparents pursuant to their will. I have family heirlooms. That's my father's and my father's and mother's when they were married. I don't have any of those. I don't even know where my father's remains are. I don't know if he's been scattered, buried. I have no clue where he's at. Have zero closure in this matter. This is my father. He's the reason I'm on this earth. And I have zero connection to him, and everything he's got will eventually be in a garbage bag and be in a dumpster or be sold, what already hasn't been. There's a lot of questions for a lot of people. I've contacted, on another note, Richard Gray as well. He doesn't have anything from his sister Deborah. He was promised a funeral, a memorial, a viewing. Was told that his sister's wishes were being carried out, which is not the truth. Purpose of this video is to bring to light the facts that I've found with my research, and I'm looking for someone that will help me. I've exhausted every avenue that I know to go. As I said before, I know Charles Hall, the former mayor of Tellico. I went by his home and showed him the documents that I have. He immediately looked at the signatures and agreed with me that it was not my father's signature. I respect this man. I always had a good relationship with him. I think he's a good man. I've contacted recently Reverend Bill Clark of Irensburg Methodist Church. Met with him and his wife in their home. Showed him the documents immediately. He agreed with me that this was not my father's signature. very nice man. Prayed with me before I left. I attempted to contact Linda DeCandio, a minister of the Church of God, also lives in Cocoa Creek. She declined to meet with me, but offered to pray for me. I've contacted Sheriff Bill Bivens of Monroe County Sheriff's Department. I've contacted Steve Bebb, our district attorney. I've contacted the Attorney General in Nashville, Mr. Cooper, faxed papers to him shortly after my father's death and shortly after my current situation of criminal charges. I met with, let me get his name here. I met with Calvin Rockholt after speaking with Mr. Bebb. Mr. Rockholt met me at the Hardee's in Madisonville. I showed him all the documents that I have. He taped that conversation. He asked for a copy of all my documents. I said I would exchange that for a copy of our meeting today, a tape. He refused to give me a copy of that tape, said that he would get back with me. He has yet to get back with me at all. He's got both sets of, he's seen both sets of papers that prove everything I'm saying. I called the governor of Tennessee, his office. They screened the call to the point to where they wouldn't let me speak with the governor. I called the Tennessee Bureau of Investigation. They said that they can't investigate any case unless it's referred to them from law enforcement. There's been plenty of opportunity for law enforcement to let TBI investigate this. That hasn't happened. I've contacted the Federal Bureau of Investigation in the Knoxville office. I told them my name was Mr. Young. They put me on hold for 7.5 minutes, came back, called me by my first name, told me they couldn't help me, and when I started to answer their statement, they hung up on me. I contacted the Memphis branch. They said they were too far away, that they couldn't do anything. I'd have to take care of things locally. I contacted the Washington, D.C. branch of the FBI. They told me the same thing. No matter where I've gone, they have closed the door in my face. I have absolutely undisputed proof of a forged will and possibly more. And I have exhausted every avenue that I know as a citizen to resolve this issue and have absolutely no help from anyone, anywhere, of any stretch of the imagination, in any form. And that's just not justice. So what I'm asking everyone out there to do is to contact as many people as you can. Link this to a website if you have it. Link this to your Facebook site page. Contact as many people as you can. All your friends, all your family, whether you think they can help or not, whether you think they're interested in this or not, whether you think they can do anything or not, they may be able to do something or know someone that you're not aware of. Contact all means of media, radio, television, anything. I'm relying on you, we the people, to stand up and help me get the rights that God has given us and the Constitution promises us and guarantees us. I'm asking for your help, for anything you can do. I'm not asking for a penny, but I have had several people email me and ask me if they could help in that way because they have no way they can help other than that. I'm not going to lie. I have mounting attorney's bills. A lot of this stuff I can't take care of because I can't afford an attorney to fight the probate case. I've exhausted all my friends' credit lines and personal savings, my personal savings. I've sold everything that I can possibly sell. And what I haven't sold is for sale, trying to get up enough money to pay the current attorney that I have so that he'll fight this criminal case for me. The date of this video is February the 17th, 2004. My court date is on the February the 27th, 2014. I think I said 2004 earlier, but this is February the 17th, 2014, and it is now, my court date's on February the 27th, 2014. It's upstairs, criminal court in Monroe County Courthouse. If you can be there, I want to fill the courtroom, out the door and down the street, to show these people that, you know, that I have a lot of support, and a lot of people have viewed this video and have seen the undisputed proof, and just ask questions. Ask a whole lot of questions. That's what I'm hoping for. I've put myself in great danger by making this video. I'm smacking the hornet's nest, so to speak. I've put my witnesses in danger. This is not something to take lightly. I'm trying the best I can to uncover an untold amount of corruption, in my opinion. This has been very, you know, this has been very trying on my nerves and on my finances. And I don't know what else to do but to turn to you, the people. Anything that I have in my possession, you're welcome to, as far as these documents. If you're an attorney or anybody at all that can help me in my situation, I will be happy to send any and all information to you, whether it be recordings of phone calls, whether it be documents. Google these people, these people's names, the individual that's living in my father's home. Google his name, see his track record, see the kind of things that he's been involved in his life. Google Monroe County. There's hours of reading in there on the corruption in Monroe County. There's a lot of things that's happened in the last several years that there's still no answers for. I think you'll find it to be interesting reading. Just please do anything you can. At the close of this video, I will put up on the screen all the phone numbers that are necessary. I'll put up our Congress and Senator's phone number for this local area. I recommend that you call your Congressman and your Senator, regardless of what state you're in, no matter where you are. I want to blanket the country with this information. Of all the things I've seen on YouTube that go viral, I would hope this would be one of them. This is my last-ditch effort for justice. These people have witnessed the proof that I have, and they are trying to put me in prison for the rest of my natural life. They've already financially broke me. They've put me in debt in the excess of $50,000, and I need your help. So at the end of this video, you'll see all the phone numbers you need. Please contact these people. Don't just contact them once. Put it in your phone, contact them every day, make them answer you. It's their duty to answer you in writing. Have them answer you in writing, make a statement in writing of what they've told you over the phone, and continue to call these people, aggravate these people. These people are your public officials, and they have a duty to you. I have sworn an oath to the Constitution to defend against all enemies, foreign and domestic. I take that oath very, very seriously. I hope that my public officials that are involved in this case take it very seriously as well. I'm looking for nothing out of this court case but justice. And I want to leave you, I want to make one other thing. This is a very important book, only second to the Bible, in my opinion. It's called the Citizen's Rule Book, the Jury Handbook. I've handed hundreds of them out for free. Get a copy of it in any way you have to. Paladin Press, I think, puts them out. I'm sure you can Google it. If you're a jury member, if you're ever called for a jury, in my situation, anybody's situation, this is a must-read book. You are the last decision in the fate of that individual that's on trial. Not the judge, not the bureaucrats that are informing you to vote a certain way, telling you what to say and what to listen to. You are the last one. You are answerable to only to God and not to these officials. Do not let them intimidate you. Do not let them tell you what you can and what you cannot do. I'd like to leave you with a few quotes that I think are appropriate. This is from Isaiah 10, 1 and 2. Woe to those who declare unjust statutes and to those who continually record unjust decisions, to deprive the needy of justice and to rob the poor of my people of their rights. Another one, quote, the only thing necessary for evil to triumph is for good men to do nothing, unquote, Edwin Burke. And last but not least, Acts 5:29, quote, we must obey God rather than men, unquote. Thank you for listening to this video. Thank you for taking the time of roughly, I guess, an hour is what it'll be to sit and watch this and listen to my story. I pray that you will do everything in your power to help me or anyone like me in my position. Thank you so much for your attention to this, and thank you in advance for anything you'll do for me. I greatly appreciate it. Thank you, and God bless you.